In this video, we're going to talk about the standard deviation and what it's actually trying to measure. So often the standard deviation is presented as a formula like this, but that doesn't really give us much insight into what it's actually trying to measure. So we're going to work through this simple example here. We have four observations, and I've kept the data set simple so that we can do all the calculations in our head and focus on the concept. So we've got these four observations here, and they have a sample mean of 80. Now, I'm going to ask you to think up your own formula that helps us capture the following. We want to know, on average, how far do individual observations deviate from the mean? Okay, again, something that helps us capture on average, how far is an individual moving from the mean? So I'd suggest you take a moment, pause this video, and think about it and try and develop a formula for yourself. So chances are that as you thought about this, many of you will have come up with the following formula. First, we think, let's look at how far the first observation is from the mean. We can see that's 5 below the mean. Then how far is the second observation from the mean? How far is the third from the mean? And the fourth. And then we can average these. And if you tried working this out, you'd notice the negative numbers and the positive ones are going to cancel each other out. So you quite likely thought, well, let's take absolute values instead. Let's take the absolute value of 75 minus 80, all these absolute deviations, and average them. If we were to write this in notation, we can think of this as being how far is x1 from the mean in absolute value, how far is x2 from the mean, all the way up to how far is xn from the mean. Okay, generalizing this for n observations, and take their average or divide by n. And again, writing it in a bit more notation, sum from I going 1 up to n, the absolute deviations of xi minus x bar over n. Okay. We can see here this formula captures exactly that. Here we're getting the average of the absolute deviations. So let's write that down here. This is capturing the average absolute deviation. Okay. You may notice that the formula here looks pretty similar to the formula for the standard deviation. So we're going to get to building up the standard deviation in a moment. The first thing just to address is, why don't we just use this formula? Well, the answer is that we do. This is an alternate measure that exists. Although, part of the reason why we tend to work with the standard deviation more than this average absolute deviation is for, well, a few reasons. Other than having nice properties, if you recall, in making a plot of x versus the absolute value of x, it's not a smooth function, right? It takes on this V shape. Okay, and those who remember reaching back in some of your math, non-smooth functions are a bit more difficult to work with. So we need to think of another way to get rid of the effect of having these negative values and positive values canceling each other out. Okay, we can see the answer right here. We can also think about squaring these deviations. So let's take a look at building up that formula now. So as noted, we can think about using squared deviations. And we can look at how far was the first observation from the mean and square that. How far is the second from the mean? Squared. How far is the next from the mean? Squared. And how far is that last observation from the mean? Squared. And we can average these. Again, let's write this out a bit more general. We can look at how far is the first observation from the mean, and we can square that. How far is the second observation from the mean, and square that. All the way up to the final or nth observation, how far is that from the mean, and square that. And then divide by the number that we have. And again, writing it in notation, here we're summing from I going from 1 up to n. How far is xi from x bar squared over n? Okay, we can see this formula here, it has a name. This gets called the variance. Here are the sample variance. And if we look at this, we're calculating the average of the squared deviations. Average squared deviation. Now, one problem with this is that the units of the variance are in the units of our variable x squared. So if these here represent class grades as a percentage, this variance tells us it's in units percentage squared. So suppose this came out to be 15.3. What that would tell us is, on average, an individual's grade moves about 15.3% squared from the mean. And that doesn't really have a meaningful interpretation. So we need to find a way to get our units back to percentage itself, okay? Get back to the units of our x variable. One way we can do that is we can take the square root. So taking the square root of this is going to get us back to units of x, okay, or percentages. Okay. So that's helped us get rid of the square. So this standard deviation we can think of as being the average deviation. Mathematically, it's not quite that. Okay, it's actually the square root of the average squared deviation. Right. So rather than call it the average deviation, because it's not quite that mathematically, we call it the standard deviation. But conceptually, it's fine for you to think of it as being the average deviation, capturing, on average, how far does an individual's grade move from the mean. One other thing you might have noticed when you see this formula is that we actually have to subtract 1 in the denominator. So let's take a moment and talk about why that is. And we're going to go at it from a more conceptual point of view rather than focusing on the mathematics. So let's talk about that. So we're going to talk about why do we divide by n minus 1 here in the calculation of the sample standard deviation. Okay. So essentially this has to do with the fact that having n observations, we can think of it as we start with n pieces of information, okay, or n degrees of freedom. And we lose 1 degree of freedom every time we use our data to estimate something. So first, let's think of a simple example here of having just 1 observation. So we have x1 being 76. With just 1 observation, we use that as our estimate of the sample mean. Now, if we want to estimate the sample standard deviation, you'll notice that we can't. We've used that observation as our estimate of the mean. We have no data left to try and estimate how far do individuals move from the mean. Okay, so that's just a simple exaggerated case of n equals 1. Let's think about the context of our example and having 4 observations. So we've got x1, x2, x3, x4. And remember, we have to use these to estimate the sample mean. This is dealing with a sample of data and we don't know the population mean. So let's think of having these 4 observations here. x1, x2, x3, x4. Right. 4 observations. And again, we've used these to estimate the mean of 80. So we can think of it as we've started with 4 observations, or 4 degrees of freedom. And let's think of this first observation. This first observation, here, one of them we can think of as being free. This can take on any value that it wants. Let's suppose that it happens to be 78. The second observation, again, this observation is free. It can take on any value it wants. Let's suppose it comes out to be 79. Okay, and again, I'm using simple numbers so that we can do the calculations in our head and focus on the concept. This third observation is free. It can be any value it wants. Suppose it ends up being 81. What do you notice about this last observation? It's not free. Can't take on any value that it wants. We know that these 4 numbers have a mean of 80. So this can only take on 1 value. It has to be 82 in order to get back to that sample mean of 80. Okay, so again, we can think of We had four pieces of information, or four observations. We used them to estimate the sample mean. We lost 1 degree of freedom. Only three useful pieces of information left, or 3 degrees of freedom. So again, these here are our free observations. Here we lost 1 degree of freedom, n minus 1. Again, we can think of the four pieces of information we have are here, 1, 2, 3, and here's the fourth. So that's the intuitive conceptual explanation of it. If you'd like, you can take a look at the mathematical explanation. If you're very mathematically inclined, you might work your way through that. I always find that this conceptual explanation is usually easier for most to grasp.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to our channel. Like our videos. Share our videos. I love statistics.